Good evening and welcome to Freedom is a Constant Struggle, hosted by
Kilu Nyasha and engineered by
Nijada Handakich. We will bring you history and news of liberation struggles throughout the world. Kilu will interview activists involved with issues such as the war, poverty, the prison system, political prisoners, homelessness, the healthcare system, as well as many other issues and how they affect you. Tonight, unfortunately, we couldn't have Jennifer Friedenbach with us, but we are pleased to have Joya Van Disterlo. She's the current civil rights organizer at the Coalition on Homelessness.
And Jennifer is the executive director.
Yes. Joya works as a staff writer and writer facilitator for Poor Magazine. She has organized in San Francisco for 7 years and has worked on a range of community issues, including abuse, disability, mental health, racism, queer institutional predation, global system of oppression, and civil rights. This is a live show, and we would love to hear any questions or comments you have, so please feel free to call in at 621-4473. And now, here's Kilu.
Thank you, Nijada. And welcome, Joya, to Freedom is a Constant Struggle.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for joining us. And why don't we start right off with you talking about the coalition work, what the coalition is, what it does, et cetera.
Coalition on Homelessness has been around for about 20 years, and we work to create exits from poverty, basically. And we do that through three different systems. One is through shelter advocacy and trying to create standards in shelters and create spaces for people to live and have housing. The second area that we work in is civil rights, and that's where I work. I'm the civil rights organizer there. And we fight legislation that criminalizes people for crimes of poverty, and we work to help people clear up citations that they have for crimes of poverty, like sleeping in the park and camping in the park. And the third thing that we do is we operate the street sheet, which a lot of people in San Francisco probably know already. We produce a street sheet. Folks from the community can come in, grab some papers, and sell them, and all the proceeds go directly to folks in the community.
Right, I buy it myself from time to time. And what are some of the ways homeless people are criminalized? I understand that, everyone who reads the newspapers in San Francisco lately knows that there have been these police sweeps in Golden Gate Park. Police sweeps in downtown areas, citations given out. And I understand that if a person doesn't pay a fine, then, of course, eventually they get a warrant, et cetera. So would you break that down for our viewers?
Absolutely. It's a really horrible process. Somewhere along the line, the idea that poor folks were dirty came up. And the idea that to clean the city somehow involved sweeping the streets and cleaning poor people out of sight became a really popular tactic for addressing poverty. So we find things, people will be doing things that they have to do biologically, like cooking and eating breakfast or sleeping in the parks. That's one of our biggest fights right now, is citations surrounding people having to sleep in the park because there's nowhere else to go. There's been actually 45,000 to 50,000 citations handed out since Newsom took office, and that's tripled since...
45,000?
Yes, ma'am. And that's cost the taxpayers about $8 million to process all of those citations.
And couldn't they just build some housing for $8 million? Affordable housing?
Right. You'd think that would be the direction that people would go in. There's a really horrible gap with housing that I think people aren't aware of. There's this idea that there's services and housing available and that people are outright rejecting it. And it's just such a false image. A one-bedroom apartment averages about $1,400 to $1,500 a month in San Francisco, and workers making minimum wage around $10 an hour would have to contribute over 90% of their income to housing just to get in. And unfortunately, criteria are so strict with incomes, they're not able to get in. So one of the stereotypes that, again, that homeless folks, they don't want to work, it's a lifestyle, it's just false. 25% of homeless folks are working full or part-time. And because there were these massive cuts in the 80s, the money that would be directed to affordable housing is now being directed towards people buying luxury homes and second houses. So while money is going into housing, it's not going to the people that really need it. Then we find folks unable to get into the housing, forced to sleep on the streets, and then are given citations and tickets, which criminalize them. And like you were saying earlier, it actually makes it more difficult for them to get off the streets.
Of course. And but, you know, just to play the devil's advocate for a minute, Newsom came up with care, not cash. And so how come, you know, there should be lots of shelter beds now available for the homeless? Why aren't they accessing these shelters?
You know, that is a question that comes up so much. And care, not cash, again, that's just, it's an illusion. The care has not been there. There's about 6,000 to 10,000 homeless people in San Francisco and only about 1,500 shelter beds available. There's nowhere for these folks to go. The wait list for public housing is about 29,000 people. The wait list for Section 8 is 28,000 people. There's just
higher than I thought. I thought it was like 10,000. So it's triple what I thought it was.
It's a huge number, and these are wait lists for 2 years. And in the meantime, obviously, there's not the care, there's not the cash. Where are people supposed to go?
Right. And, of course, the homeless population that is counted on a given day who are out, literally out in the street, does not represent the entire homeless population. I myself have been homeless, but I've been fortunate enough never to have had to sleep on the street. There are people who are doubled up with relatives, with friends who have taken them in, sleeping on people's couches, on people's floors, that kind of thing. Is there not?
Oh, no, that's absolutely correct. And that's actually a category that right now they're considering taking away from being quote-unquote homeless, as if you're doubled up. So even though folks are homeless, they're kind of invisible in a way. So if the city doesn't have to count them, then they don't have to be represented. And while they have some form of shelter, it's obviously inadequate shelter.
Right. And I understand that, well, let me backpedal a little bit. I remember when Reagan first cut the budget, the HUD budget, Housing and Urban Development Budget. And I remember Silent Sam, as he used to be called, and I can't remember his last name, but he was the housing person in the cabinet. And they cut the housing budget $27 billion, the first cut.
Right.
And I understand over a period of time it's been cut even more, much more than that.
That's correct. It's my understanding that in the past 30 years, there's been $45 billion in cuts.
45. So
45.
Yeah. And so why do you think that these huge cuts in public housing were made in the first place?
I can't really postulate on what was going through the Reagan administration's mind at the time. I can only make assumptions. But what I do know is that somewhere along the line, we decided not to take care of folks, and that was okay.